account, and everybody said he's using his power in the wrong way, you know. Yeah. So anyway, but it's so funny that, that the groups that go up and meet with him, this has been a common thread. These companies, the pharmaceuticals, whoever goes up to meet with him, and he talks to them about what he wants to do. When they come back down, it's like they're coming back down from the mountain, and they have this glow about them, and they go like, he's wonderful. We love him. Everything he said is exactly what when those gold elevators open up, and they come out glowing. And so, but they've all, everybody's been very happy with the meeting that went on. And so I don't know if they gave him free rooms there or whatever, but they come down, they're very, very happy. So it's pretty
the interesting thing about the Ninth Circuit deal,
yeah,
is there was nothing about the constitutional right the president has mm-mm. mentioned in anything
right.
in
right.
the brief. And then you look at their record, mm-hmm. the fact that about 80% of their rulings get overturned at the Supreme Court. And I kind of like our
that's
kind of like our odds.
Yeah, yeah, the odds look really, really good. And if we can get Gorsuch in there,
there you go.
In yeah. there, it
well,
may.
You wonder if that Ninth District Court doesn't feel like they're a joke. If the percentage is that high, and like you're a judge,
yeah,
and your ruling's getting overturned by you know the higher court, I mean like 80% or something like that. You think they'd be?
I kind of think they wear it like a badge of honor.
You think so?
I do.
Because
they're like the, it's like the pod among the rest of the pods that yeah. we're the different pod. We're unique.
Right? They're the social justice warrior, you know,
yeah.
the district court. Yeah, yeah the political, yeah, the courts. I mean, it's like, we're standing up for what's right. Even though we're being shot down every single time, we're standing up for what's right. Just a joke.
Well, not even that. It's like whoever puts them in their place, like, hey, guys, you guys might need to work on this percentage of
yeah.
being overturned.
Yeah. Well, and they're trying to break it up because it's too powerful. It represents too much of the nation. And so they feel like this is ridiculous. You know, like it gets overturned this many times, the percentage. We need not give it so much
waiting.
Power. Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see what happens there. But I just love this administration because you never know what's going to happen. Every time you turn on the TV.
The thing I like about it
different.
Is it's so... It's different from the way people normally do business.
That's right? exactly right.
And I think that's what gets a lot of people's dander. Yeah. Dander? Can I use that word? That's kind of an old word.
It's
kind of gets people's dander up about a lot of what's going on is they're used to it being a certain way.
Right.
And they're not going to do it that way. They're going to do it in a way that tries to get the job done quickly,
right.
efficiently, whatever. I may not agree with 100% of how he rolled out
yeah.
his plan.
Yeah.
I think
sure.
it could have been done better. But
sure.
at the end of the day, I think his purpose is good. Right.
Well, the other thing, he could have taken it back, rewritten it, and it would have squelched a lot of things, what a lot
yeah.
of people said, and all. But he's got so many things that he's doing, and I'm not saying this as an advocate for Trump, but I
yeah.
just think it's ridiculous that this is the president, so we got to kind of, you know, back up a little bit, slow your roll, and not be so jump on stuff and say that. This
right.
is the worst thing that's ever happened to us, and he's not legitimate or anything like that. But I think that there's a lot going on. And when he said the word tax break, those two words caused the Dow to everybody jumped. Everybody
yeah,
in the market
yeah.
jumped. So they're all looking forward to this announcement he's going to have. Yeah. Now, I got to tell you about Kevin Brady. Kevin Brady was on Fox and Friends this morning. And it's so funny when you have somebody that you know that's, you know, hey, Kev, what's up? They go on and they say, Congressman, you know, Kevin Brady is coming on to talk to us about, he's the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee. And so that's a big deal. And so he's coming on to talk about what they're going to do in the tax reform. Now, this isn't going to be interesting to
yeah.
you, and I'm sure you've already heard this, Chris. But Joey.
Yes.
You know, have you ever filled out, you know, when you're filing for taxes or anything like that?
Yeah.
Who does that for you?
Well, I mean, I do it, but I usually do it with my mom just because she's been doing it for many years.
That's right. Okay. Okay. And or you have to go to H&R Block or somebody.
Oh, no. We do TurboTax. Yeah.
TurboTax.
We do TurboTax.
Well, he's got like a stealth tax reform plan because he showed the postcard that is going to be what you have to fill out for your tax. It's just like you make this, you subtract that, so it was amazing. And he's added things on there as that you can take off in your taxes. So my sister's a CPA, and I know she sits back and just, oy vey, if they don't stop with this changing, I was like, I don't care, but it's just somebody agree, because all the people call them and say, does that mean I can, as soon as they announce it on TV.
Yeah.
It hasn't been put into play, but this is what they're bringing up to vote on, is the tax reform and getting this down to a postcard size investment in your time to make this happen. So anyway, if you want to see that, go to Fox and Friends with Kevin Brady's on there, his interview's on there, and it's just it's so cool, very, very cool. Great things coming up, but not greater than Chris Wootton and his financial group that's we're going to be talking about as soon as we get back. Money, 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 money. We're going to be talking about it, and I love money and food. Okay, you're listening to the Cindy Cochran Show, and we're so glad you're with us. Don't go away. It's going to be more fun. And movies later. Remember the last segment, movies. Yeah.
The Cindy Cochran Show, the first daily talk show serving Montgomery County.
Hi, this is Cindy Cochran, and just wanted to thank you for listening. And remember, I'm live Monday through Friday at 10 a.m., and you can interact with the show through my Facebook page, The Cindy Cochran Show. It's real reality radio. Hey, give your ears a...
The Cindy Cochran Show? You ain't heard nothing yet.
And we're back. Dennis is right. You ain't heard nothing yet. We've got Chris Woot in the house. The Wootton Financial Group is a staple here in the Conroe area. Everybody knows about this group, this financial group. And what we're going to do is probably dispel some of the mysteries of going in and talking to a financial planner and all that. But Chris, tell us a little bit about there's been a lot of change or a lot of things happening.
Oh, my goodness.
You're in it. Yeah. You are in it, man.
Well, a lot of people are probably more familiar with who we were, the name prior to a purchase that I made back at the end of November. And
Small purchase.
That's right. Craig Weir Financial Group is a local firm, investment advisory financial planning firm that's been around for a long time. Craig, in the industry more than 30 years, built a practice. I came on board with that practice a little over 12 years ago, and we built it together, and, we're kind of what the industry would call a boutique firm. We're kind of small. We like it that way. At this point, we got about 350 households that we manage money for and do financial planning and so forth.
That's small. That would be a smaller firm. Small. Wow. Yeah.
So November 30th, all that kind of changed. Mm-hmm. And one thing that people may not know about the financial industry, especially if you think about the independent shop, where people come in and they invest their money and do planning work and so forth for retirement or whatever it may be, is that there's a huge shortage of people to take the place of people that have been in the industry like Craig for 30 years that are looking to retire or whatever the case is.
Right.
Well, I was kind of the succession plan for our firm. And so Craig and I had always talked about, at some point when he got ready to retire, I was going to be kind of the guy that came in and, if I wanted it, take over. So November 30th, I purchased Game Plan Advisors, which is the registered investment advisory side, the money management side of what we do, and also Craig Weir Financial Group, which was kind of the insurance financial planning arm of what we do, kind of goes away, and Wootton Financial Group comes in and takes its place. So bottom line is, still the same company. Our clients don't, they're not really going to see much of a change at all.
Right.
Craig didn't technically retire. He just moved on to a different aspect of the industry. And gotcha. So
and he still has his phone and a pen.
That's right. But here's the neat thing. The neat thing about it is, Craig's always been a visionary.
Mm-hmm.
He could see trends in the market 4 or 5 years ahead of time and react to them. And even before our industry was screaming about the shortfall of having people to take the place of these guys that want to retire, he was preparing that way.
Right.
Okay. And so when the time came, and we weren't even really planning to do it last year, we begin to look at the mechanics of how to do a transition, and that's when we found out if we don't do this now, we may not be able to do it 5 years from now, just because of growth and things like that.
You had to have had a feeling of being groomed. Did you?
Oh, certainly.
Yeah. Okay, all right.
And you know what? I count that as an advantage because we're in an industry that, let's just be honest, doesn't have the best reputation around, okay, because of the guys out there that get all the media attention that, you know, hose their client and the Bernie Madoffs of the world, okay? And I count it fortunate that the guy I learned this business from was a man of extreme integrity and character.
Absolutely.
In an industry where that's, just honestly speaking, there's a lack of it, okay?
Yeah.
So, you know, I feel very fortunate and blessed in that regard that I learned the business from him. We've got just a fantastic group of clients. You know, it's like family. We're a small shop. We like it that way. We want to keep it that way. Now, we grow organically, and that's just going to happen. But we purposefully have built an environment at the firm where you feel like you're walking into your living room when you sit down to meet. And I hope that's how people feel when they come in.
Well, you know, a lot of people, I think, are afraid and are intimidated to walk into a financial planner or when they call it an estate plan. You know, like, I don't have an estate. I got this little apartment, and I don't make this much money. But it isn't true, and I think that would be a great thing to dispel, is the amount of money that you feel like you have, it's a good amount for you, but you're afraid that it's not going to be much to this guy. These guys do financial planning. Yeah. You got to have millions or something like that.
Well, it is true that there are some advisors that have account minimums, and there's different reasons for that, okay? And there's not necessarily a right or wrong model. There's just difference, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
We don't have minimums. Never have. I believe that the guy that has $10,000 saved worked just as hard to get his $10,000 saved as a guy that has $10 million, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Both of them believe that pot of money, if you will, is important,
and
they want somebody to help them take care of it, right?
Absolutely.
Now, there's different ways to go take care of it. And so everybody, if you think about, you know, economics and guys like me that, for instance, we don't farm out our portfolios to other corporate entities in New York or someplace like that. We manage everything in-house, so all of our trading's done in-house, all of our portfolio management's done in-house. A lot of firms aren't like that. A lot of firms are set up to be more of a sales-type shop where the guy you meet with is just a face guy. He's not really making any decisions on the trading front or the portfolio front. He's just there to move product and to bring in more money, okay?
Right.
It's not that that's necessarily a bad thing. You just, as a consumer, have to decide what you believe is a better way. What's more important to you? Do you like commissions? Do you like fees? You know, that kind of thing. Those kind of differences are what you want to look for. And there's so much, you know, there's so many resources online now where you can kind of go and educate yourself about those kind of things. Obviously, I'm happy to talk to anybody about it, but we have always been a fee-based, independent financial advisory firm.
When you say fee-based, is this a percentage that...
So we manage money based on a percentage of the amount of assets that we manage annually.
Okay.
Whereas other shops may typically earn a commission when they sell you a mutual fund or when they make a transaction to trade something in your portfolio, they get paid on a commission they make by moving that product.
Gotcha.
We just believe that the fee model is a better model because it puts us on the same side of the table as the client. If a client's account value goes down, what happens to my income?
Yeah, there's no conflict of interest in this way.
I think it reduces conflict of interest,
okay? Right.
Conflict of interest many times is in the eye of the beholder, okay? The difference between me and, let's say, a commission-based shop, and by the way, there's a lot of legal stuff in play right now with the Department of Labor and the SEC and so forth that's forcing these firms that are have been commission-based. I mean, Craig and I have been fee-based and an RIA that has a fiduciary capacity for as long as I've been with him, okay? Whereas these other shops are just now, within the last year or so, being forced by new laws to take on fiduciary roles and be legally responsible for recommending what's in the best interest of their clients. We've been doing that for 20 years, okay? So we kind of know how to navigate those waters, And unlike those shops, I've always had to disclose to a client any type of conflict of interest that may exist. Right. So, for instance, if I did have something that I recommended to them where, let's just assume it had a commission tied to it or something along those lines. Well, if I do that, that's outside of my fee arrangement. Mm-hmm. I had to disclose to the client the commission and so forth as to what was going on, right? Well, so that they can make a right decision.
You threw that word at me again.
Okay.
Fiduciary. Fiduciary. Do you know what fiduciary means?
I do not.
Richard, do you know what fiduciary means? I don't know. I mean, sometimes people that are in the business and they've got buzzwords or they have words that just, you know, everybody else knows. So would you explain fiduciary?
Okay. The simplest way to explain it is you have a legal obligation to do what is in the best interest of the client that you're helping, you're representing, okay? If a regulator walked into my door tomorrow morning and pulled 5 client files and looked at what I did with those clients, I would have to be able to prove why I recommended to them what I recommended was the best thing for them, okay? Now, that doesn't mean that it had to be the cheapest or, you know, those types of things. I mean, it's kind of a, it can be a subjective view, if you want to think of it in those terms. Mm-hmm. Sometimes something that costs a little more is a better product, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can't think of it just in terms of cost, although that's a part of it. You've got to think of it in terms of, for instance, if I go into a firm and all they offer are what are called proprietary products. So in other words, they're only products offered by that firm. Okay. And I'm not going to mention names, but certain mutual funds, their offices will only sell that mutual funds.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Well, obviously that's a conflict of interest because you're not looking at anything outside of just that body of funds to recommend to somebody. Okay. And it doesn't mean the mutual funds are bad.
Yeah.
It just means the client is ignorant to any other option. And so all we're trying to do is present clients with options as to, here's what you're doing now.
Yeah.
Here's what you could be doing over here. Here's some different ways to solve the problem. Mm-hmm. Now, Mr. Client, here's what I believe would be best. What do you think?
Mm-hmm. Right? There you go.
So part of what you're trying to decide when you walk into a financial firm is, what kind of philosophy do you hold about investing? And most people have never even thought of that type of thing. Right? Wow.
So if you went in and asked that question, that would put that, you know, the guy, the financial planner, in a position of like, wait a minute, this guy may know what he's doing. And maybe he knows more than we think. And maybe he's been Googling things and we have to find out what he knows before we submit something to him. I think it's funny because when people do come in and come into, it's like, I'll take a comparison, it's like a woman going into a mechanical shop.
Right.
And I'm not saying all women are like this, but majority of women do not have a clue of what they're going to try and explain to them what they is happening to their car.
Right.
And so they have to go with sounds and, you know, and it does this and it does that and it goes the most, and I don't know what the sound is making and I don't understand it. So they hate going into the mechanics place. They hate going into a lot of times to buy a car because they immediately feel like they're going to be taken advantage of because they don't have all this knowledge of everything. So I think that if someone walks into a place and they can ask the questions, not be made to feel stupid, and if they don't have a lot of money, but you may explain to them, here's what we need to do, here's the plan, and that's what you do. And can they come in, and do they have a free interview with you at the beginning?
That's a great question. Yeah, I mean, we have built our business on the premise that if you add value to the client up front, we understand not everybody's going to do business with us, and that's okay. We're going to retain the people that are meant to be there, and the ones that aren't, that's why God made the other shops, right?
Yeah, there you
absolutely
go.
So,
but here's the bottom line. We want you to, even if you come in and you sit down, which we don't charge anything for normally the first 2 meetings. The first meeting is kind of a get to know one another. We gather information, find out what your goals are, what you're trying to get accomplished. We go back to our nerd room, so to speak, and then our second meeting, we're getting back together and presenting the findings. Here's what we believe you're doing correctly. Here are the places we think that you could do some improving, and here's how we believe we could help you with that or add value to you. at the end of the day, the client gets to decide
right.
before they've put any money up front whether or not the value we believe we can offer is worth what we say we believe it's worth.
Right.
And if that means that they don't and they go somewhere else and go down the hall or, you know, to another shop or whatever, we're okay with that because at the end of the day, if you walk away, you at least have more ammunition in your belt
right.
to be able to ask really good, qualified, right. intelligent questions of the next person you go and sit down with.
Well, I love that. I love that philosophy. That's very good to empower the people. But when somebody comes in and their whole purpose in life is, I want to make more money, and I want you to make me more money, and can you promise me you'll make me more money, and then I'll go with you.
Okay.
So when we come back from this break,
all right.
that's the question I'd love for you to answer.
Sure,
you don't mind.
Absolutely.
We have Chris Wootton with us. Oh, y'all thought I was going to say something bad, right? Chris Wootton is with us with the Wootton Financial Group, and he's helping us understand
yeah.
money and planning and all that.
Oh, yeah.
My head is hurting. Oh, my God. You're listening to the Cindy Cochran Show, Real Reality Radio.
The Cindy Cochran Show, Real Reality Radio.
Remember, live is better. And if you can, join me Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. and interact live on the show through my Facebook page. Let's get your morning started.
The Cindy Cochran Show, the first daily talk show serving Montgomery County.
And we're back on the Cindy Cochran Show with Chris Wootton of the Wootton Financial Group. Are the game, do you want to be called the game, game plan?
Well, we are called game plan advisors, but it's two different sides of what we do.
Okay,
but,
okay, because yeah. I want to make sure that I get the right.
Well, here's the thing. People right now when they're coming in, we're in a transition period.
Right.
So we just made the purchase in November, and so people are coming in and they're like, well, that sign on your wall still says Craig Weir Financial Group. Yeah, that's because we haven't gotten to that yet. We've got a year to get this done.
Transition. But
absolutely.
What's great is that you've been there 12 years. So it's not like you walked in and said, here's the money for this place, and okay, now I'm going to tear it apart.
Yeah, as busy as it all is, I think the thing that is kind of the bummer out of it is Craig was more like a brother to me than he was anything.
Oh.
Or I say was, is. I'm talking about him like he's dead. He's not dead. He's still around.
Chris, we love you.
That's right, Craig, we love you. Craig, just not being able to get to see him on a daily basis like we used to, you know, throw pencils at one another, shoot rubber bands, those kind of things.
That's great. You have that kind of relationship, and so
sure.
yeah.
that's what people that are still clients and love to hear because they knew you and they met mm-hmm. you and they talked to you and all that. But to know that you had the same philosophy, same feelings and stuff that Craig has. So that's good. That's very good.
Yep.
Now, the question I ask is, if people come in and say, I just want to make money, can you promise me to make a lot of money? Is it going to happen this year? And in fact, I got to pay my rent next year. So, but when people come in and ask all the crazy questions, I guess they do ask and try and get you to promise them. What is it that you feel like you can
That's a good question.
Make them feel good about?
I guess probably the best place to start is, what do you need?
There you go. I want $1 million.
No, I mean, if they're talking about... Go make me money in the market is a very subjective question,
right.
okay? Because it's... The first question I would ask is, well, what rate of return do you really need?
Mm-hmm.
Most people have no idea.
No.
Okay? We don't start with products and return. What we start with is a financial plan. Let's find out what you have, where you want to go, and then figure out if right now you have enough to get where you want to go based on what you're doing.
Okay.
And more importantly, based on all of those things that you have in place now or what you're going to be adding over the next 20 years, or, you know, depending on your age and those kind of things, what rate of return do you really need to go get in the market to make life work for you? See, here's the thing. Most people are programmed by the financial industry to chase return.
Mm-hmm.
Now, who does that advantage? The financial industry,
yes.
Nothing wrong, bad, you know, that's what they're there for. They're there to make money. But
yeah.
at the same time, the client needs to be aware that if you don't need to go take the risk that is involved in making your plan work to make, let's say, 12%,
yeah.
and you only need to take enough risk to go make 6%, well, it would make sense to me that I would not want to invest to make 12%. Okay? But if you don't know that,
right,
then you're just going into the financial office and they're saying, well, okay, answer these 10 questions on this survey, and that's going to tell us what portfolio you need to go into. And there's nothing wrong with that. You need to do a risk assessment, but that risk assessment should be tied to your financial plan. If you do a risk assessment, Cindy, and let's say you're 5 years away from retirement.
Yes.
If you do a risk assessment and it tells me that you're the most aggressive investor on the face of the planet, you should be running a hedge fund, okay? But you tell me in your financial plan that, well, I don't want to lose any money. Okay, well, number one, those are at odds, right?
Yeah.
I've seen it. And so then I have to come in and try to figure out, well, where in the middle do we put you in a portfolio?
Mm-hmm.
You're aggressive on the investing side, but you also are telling me that you don't want to lose any money from the standpoint of being able to retire in a certain time frame, right?
Right.
That's where an advisor comes into play, a guy like me. So, for instance, I think that's where a lot of, we were talking about millennials earlier.
Yes.
I think that's where a lot of millennials are going to run into problems is that millennials statistically, statistically millennials are on the low end of the scale when it comes to financial knowledge, financial acumen.
Yes.
No offense, Joey.
No.
And here's the thing.
My generation is terrible at it.
I am not making blanket statements about millennials. I think it's as widely varied as my generation is.
Sure.
Okay?
Sure.
But generally speaking, they tend to have a low financial acumen on, let's say, a 5-question survey, but they tend to be very high in people that actually have retirement accounts open where they work. Mm-hmm. So they have a very high percentage compared to former younger generations as to what they're willing to do, right?
Okay.
Now, where they kind of fall through the cracks is they tend to have a lot of debt because of student loans, credit cards, those kind of things. So they're trying to figure out how to get out of that. Mm-hmm. They're not typically saving enough into their retirement plans to, accomplish what it is in their mind. But they're not like you and me. Our generations were materialistic. Our money went towards stuff.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Millennials are more experiential. In other words, they're going to spend their money on experiences, travel, helping people in Uganda put in water wells, those kind of things, right? And it kind of depends on what you're talking about. But point just being, how I deal with a baby boomer or a Gen Xer is going to be different as to how I deal necessarily with a millennial.
Mm. Sure. Okay. Now, speaking of the market, since the election, and we've gone to our 20,000.
Sure.
Yeah, 20,000. Yeah.
We're at market highs.
At market highs.
Yeah.
That's right, though. 20,000 is where it is, right?
Close enough.
Yeah. Thereabout.
20,155?
I don't even know.
Okay.
I haven't looked at it since we got on the air.
I saw that. No, I'm kidding. It was that way yesterday. But anyway, looking at that and the, is that everybody's like, wait a minute, why didn't I get in that before? And is this still going to continue or is this something that's going to end? Are people calling you and saying, should we be more aggressive and all that? They are.
But here's the thing. Most investors get in and out of the market at exactly the wrong time because they don't have a discipline in their approach to how they invest. They invest based on information and emotion.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let me tell you how the financial industry markets to the general populace. They use two things, fear and greed.
Oh, yeah.
And when you use those two emotions to market,
people
tend to make decisions at really poor periods of time.
Yeah.
And guess who benefits from that? You guessed it.
Yeah.
Okay.
But you would be, wouldn't they look at you and say, you told me it was okay to invest in that, and don't you carry that burden when they lose? Would they lose?
Every night when I go to bed.
Do you make them sign something and say, you made me invest in this. I didn't want you to do this.
No, I mean, you got to understand kind of how to prepare somebody on the front end for what investing does.
Well, that's right, because you're educating them.
Yeah, I mean, there's no guarantee that you're going to make X return, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What we're doing is we're using historical performance to try to predict, if you will. That's not the word I like to use, but how things will happen in the future. Well, those are constantly, evolving things. Economics change, world events change, yeah, those kind of things. So it's a very dynamic thing that you have to watch. And really what we manage more than money is client emotions. And guess which one's harder?
Oh,
it's
just
much harder
only
to manage a client emotion than it is to manage their money.
Let me tell you, so, I don't know what your barometer was to find out where the market is and how, except by going to, you know, the internet or whatever. Uh-huh. All I had to do was say, "Honey, how are you doing?" And the look on his face, his whole demeanor, I was just, you know, like, I knew the market was down. I said, "How much did we lose today?" Because he had so much invested at one time in the market.
Yeah.
And so he came in one time, he said, "We just lost in the last 15 minutes $300,000. And I went, "What? What?" And he goes, I got to sit down. I mean, but he was so emotional, and it came back. Because he's very patient. He puts stuff in and is going to stay. And that's how, to me, seeing it over the years, if people can be consistent or patient and watch it, because it is going to go up and down, and when to get out.
Well, I hope that part of what we provide to a client is the ability to walk in and lay that stress on somebody else.
There you
okay?
go.
If you're sitting in front of your computer every day and you're paying someone to manage your money and you're still sitting in front of the computer every day watching the numbers, I'm going to tell you straight up, you're stressing yourself out.
That's okay? right.
I mean,
that's right.
No, that's what you pay us to do is to stress out for you. And it is, to answer your question earlier, it is stressful. Mm-hmm. I mean, you learn to deal with it and manage it over time. It's just as stressful for me when, let's say, a client has a bad year and we lose money, mm-hmm. which it happens, mm-hmm. right? 2015 was a terrible year. It was very difficult for money managers in general to make money.
Yeah.
Fast forward to this year, or excuse me, last year, decent year, right? If you look at November till the end of the year.
That's what I was saying.
Yeah,
November.
Exactly.
November on.
And so, how you manage the risk of those types of years to me is more important than, let's say, the return that somebody makes, right? Because you just said it, if we're at market highs, if you invest in a way that constantly exposes you to the market risk that you don't necessarily need, which is a very high percentage of people that come and see us, okay? Right. When I evaluate where they are risk-wise, most of them are taking too much risk, right?
But here's something I've got to tell you, is we're out of time.
Sorry.
No. I'm sitting here and I can barely look over and see Richard give me do that sign. And I talked about circle. See on TV, you'll see what sign it is. Anyway, but I wanted to tell you how interesting. I never listen to money stuff. I mean, Sam starts talking about it. But this has been very interesting. And I want to just real quick, you will talk to couples coming in financially planning for their future before they get married. And it's a good way to get them together. And,
absolutely.
And that's
absolutely
like a whole different show. And I would love to have a show just on that. That's great. But the Wootton Financial Group will do that.
Yep, yeah. We sure will.
So.
Yeah, and I would love to bring my girlfriend in. Like when we get closer to marriage and everything, I would love to come in and talk with y'all.
I highly recommend it. If the number one cause of divorce is finances, then hit it off at the pass and get in before you get married.
Exactly.
Okay,
give them
how to get hold of you.
Our office number is 936-449-5952.
Okay, we'll have to put that on my Facebook page and have to come there.
Awesome.
You can also go to wootonfinancial.com, WOOTTONfinancial.com.
WOOTTON. Chris, thank you so much for being here. And
thank
as
you
the
for
music has
me.
Died down, I'm now in trouble. I'm not going to look at Richard. You're listening to the Cindy Cochran Show, Real Reality Radio.
The Cindy Cochran Show. You ain't heard nothing yet.
Hey, this is Cindy. Just wanted to thank you personally for listening. Remember, live is even more fun, Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. And if you or someone you know would like to sponsor the Cindy Cochran Show, please message me on my Facebook page, The Cindy Cochran Show.
The Cindy Cochran Show, the most opinionated talk show on radio.
We're back on the Cindy Cochran Show. Man, that was so much fun.
Absolutely.
I learned so much. But don't get excited, Sam. That doesn't mean that it's going to take and I'm going to be really good and with money now and all that.
Yeah.
I still got to go shopping this up. Okay, no, but that was really good. And I think...
The Cindy Cochran Show. Welcome back.
Oh, welcome back to the Cindy Cochran Show. I got so excited about that, and I was trying to... we were talking about money, and now we're going to talk about movies quickly and about what's come out. There are a lot of
interesting movies that came out.
Now, Lego Batman starts today, right?
Yeah, I believe so, yes.
Okay. And they're saying that it's going to be funny because Lego Batman is going to kill 50 Shades of Grey.
Darker, oh, yeah. Well, see, it's like a sequel off of the Lego movie that came out like a year ago,
I love that movie.
And it's the same character, same Batman. So it's just following like this story arc of that Batman. And if you've seen the previews, it's hilarious.
Right.
I really want to see it.
Did you see the first one?
I did not, no.
Oh, go back and see the first one.
I do. I do need to go see it.
It's so good. No, it's so good. And this has gotten really good reviews.
Yeah,
well.
Oh, yeah. So. And I think it was Mr. Wootton who said that Lego Batman is projected to just murder 50 Shades Darker in theaters. I'm so happy about that.
I think that's hilarious.
Personally.
I think it's hilarious because, you know, when they think they're so cool and they've got this down, they got, let's do, you know, all this gratuitous sexual movie.
Yeah.
But the Batman Lego is going to be so much fun. And
absolutely.
Finally, something good has come out for the kids. You know, they had really, you know, nothing's going on. What else is...
We got John Wick Chapter 2.
Okay, everybody wants to see that.
Yeah, if you saw the original John Wick. I did not see the original John Wick, but I have a lot of coworkers and friends who did, and they all loved it. And so I'm trying to see if I can watch it before John Wick Chapter 2 because it looks amazing.
That's right, because some movies, you're right, some movies you have to know it's something going on, you know, what happened in the past. But I like the ones that can do it standalone. You know, like Jack Reacher, and I love Jack Reacher. And so, but I love Keanu Reeves, and so it'll be fun.
See, that's the thing. I'm not a big fan of Keanu Reeves, but I love...
Boo.
I know.
What's
like,
wrong
I'm,
with
I'm
you?
The,
he's my
I'm
favorite
in,
actor.
I'm in the minority for some reason.
Yes, you are.
but he's just not my kind of...
Let me ask you this, though.
Yeah.
What movies has he been in that you didn't like?
Okay, we'll see. Okay, I see where you're going with it. It's not the movie itself that I dislike because he's in it. It's just him as an actor. I don't necessarily enjoy his delivery or something like that. But the movies, yes, you're exactly right. They are very enjoyable, like Matrix. I loved Much Ado About Nothing, where he played the main villain.
Yes.
You know, I loved that movie.
Speed.
I haven't seen that.
Of course, The Lake House. That's probably his best movie.
Oh, that was good. That was really good. Now wait. What's the one? Shoot.
Bill and Ted Excellent Adventure.
See, I'm afraid.
Bogus
that if
Adventure.
You, wait, I'm afraid if you've seen those, that it was going to be hard to make a transition to take him seriously and take him.
I don't
as
know.
A
Speed's
actor.
Really good.
But that was a he did some really good transition movies.
And The Devil's Advocate was really good.
Oh my word! Yes,
he
was
really good in that.
Oh yeah, that was good.
I think I've seen that one. I don't know.
And so we don't know what you're talking about.
But John Wick, yeah, he was perfect for... He's perfect for roles where he doesn't have more than, like, 10 minutes of dialogue.
I will say that. I mean, he does know how to move on screen. Like, he is very...
He did all those stunts,
detail-oriented,
which is incredible to me. Or not all of them, but it's pretty cool watching the people who made John Wick. They do the tactical shot scenes, how they do them. Because they're all live.
Yeah.
Like, it's all in one shot, so they
He's shooting and killing more people in this one.
Good.
And a lot of it's based about this dog, and everybody loves dogs, and if you love shooting, but he doesn't, it's like
a
as
total guy's
not...
movie. He's got dogs, he's got the love for a dog, it's got
man's best friend.
Guns, and
violence.
It's got violence.
As long as it's not gratuitous shooting.
Oh, it is.
That's what...
actually, what's funny, I got a comment from, it was my uncle said, that what's really crazy about this movie is he kills them in a tactical way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He does two to the chest, one to the head. Like, everybody in the movie gets two to the chest, one to the head. And, like, that's how you're supposed to efficiently kill somebody.
Wow.
To the chest and
one
to
the head. Yeah, that's what, how some
what goes
are
first? The chest? Chest. Of it. The yeah. chest goes first. So you once you shot out the heart,
no, it's apparently that's the way you do confirmed kills or something like that. That's how you make sure
they're gone.
Wow. I think the whole everyone who dies in the first one, 80% of them are dead or get shot in the head.
Wow.
So it's insane. It's like happens so fast though, like, cause that's what I'm saying, the action scenes it just goes.
Yeah.
And it's like Jason Bourne but more violent.
That's what it feels like. That's a good point.
Well, I love that stuff. I mean, I love that stuff. And one of the critics were saying they didn't like it because there was too much killing. I went, what? Why are you critiquing
well,
movies?
Well, I was even surprised. My mother, I was talking to her because Holly is coming up this part of town. And I was like, I'm going to go take her to go see John Wick on Sunday because I really want to see it.
Yeah.
And she's like, oh, we're going to go see it on Saturday.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, you've already seen the first one? And she's like, yeah, we saw the first one. And I was like, whoa. Because like my parents are not about that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
But she liked it.
Wow.
This is a closet adventure killing, you know, person.
I mean, this movie's violent. Yeah. I don't think people were like, I mean, it's violent.
But see, I like to go see how they do the violence. Because if they do it where it's, you know, smart or that's creative or we haven't seen that before and that kind of thing, I like that.
I would say in this movie, everything's really takes place at night. So it's not like, it's not celebratory violence where people are like breaking arms and people are screaming and all that kind of stuff. It's just, it's basically, they're trying to take a real perspective on if some guy went into a room and had to kill 10 people, how would he do it and realistically and what would really happen? And even though like some of the stuff's kind of far-fetched, but if someone just went in there and started shooting people and he was good at shooting people, what kind of damage would it do to the room, to the audience, like to everything? And, and it's not as like, there's just blood everywhere. And people are yelling. It's just quick. Like, he's just going through it.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It's really cool.
Well, I think that I saw a movie where the way the bullet entered the people and the way that they reacted to it, it's the first time I'd seen something like that. I went, oh, good, they've got something different going on there.
Yeah.
But I like gore. Okay, anyway, Joey, thank you so much for being here.
It is my pleasure. Thank
and
you.
And I hope that you've learned something today.
I very much did, yes.
And listeners, and so... Richard, I hope you have a great weekend. You too, Joey.
Thank you.
Joey.
You too,
Joey. Gosh. Why can't I remember names? Okay. Anyway. Okay, honey, I'll be home soon. You think you're still listening? Probably not. Okay, guys, have a great weekend. Enjoy yourself. Next week.
See some movies.
Next week we have Whodunit, of course. On Monday and Tuesday we have Bill Shepard from the Cinemark Tinseltown coming in to remind us about the film fest that we're going to have, first film fest in the Woodlands. Okay, guys, have a great weekend.
Thanks for checking out this production on Lone Star Community Radio, Montgomery County's radio station. For more information on this show and other shows on Lone Star, check us out online at irlonestar.com. If you're interested in sponsoring a program on Lone Star Community Radio and reaching the local audience of Montgomery County on FM, internet, and TV media, please call 936-647-5747 or contact us online at irlonestar.com. This recording is a Lone Star Community Radio production, produced by the show host and Dick Schissler of Lone Star Community Radio. Interested in volunteering as a music DJ or starting your own talk show? Contact Dick Schissler at dick@irlonestar.com or by phone at 936-647-5747.